special presentation.
Is Much More Music Live with Lisa Marie Presley. You know, we've been reading about her since before she was old enough to read. She had a very storied life, and throughout it all, she's had the spark and talent to establish her own identity. She's got two killer records underneath her belt, including the brand new one that is Now What. She's heard it before. She's here to answer some of your questions, making her live, in-depth Canadian television debut. Make some noise, Lisa Marie Presley. This is all about the brand new record, Now What. Can you even hear me?
I can't hear you. Thank you.
We have to talk to Lisa. Oh, okay, that's good.
Wow, thank
you. Welcome, first of all. How are you?
I'm good. Wow, I'm awake now.
Yeah, I was feeling sort of a little bit tired, and all of a sudden I'm peppy now. This is gonna be good. You were joking after.
Thank you.
Welcome, sorry. First of all.
Thank you.
Glad to have you here. After the first record.
Sorry.
After To Whom It May Concern in 2003, I think you kind of joked, you know, want to tell your system, maybe you'll go back to being a recluse.
Right.
You're still
I know.
Here.
Like, you can't get rid of me. I know. It's terrible.
I'm wondering if it was something in the promoting of that record, or maybe something during the shows, that made you think that you were on the right path. Yes, this is what you were meant to do.
You know, actually, I did the record because I'm a huge music fan, and music's always had a huge effect on me in my life. And I just maybe naively thought I'd put a record out and see if it would, you know, if I would affect others. And I kind of, through that whole episode, at the end of the first record, like headlining my first tour in the U.S., realized that I had a huge fan base, and I had in fact done that. So, you know, by the letters and the stories and whatever from my songs, inspired me to go on and do the second record, because I realized I sort of accomplished my goal.
Well, and I was wondering if, while you're promoting it, if there was sort of a curiosity factor, or, you know, there were people that had opinions even before hearing a note.
You mean curiosity factor from others?
Just, you know, well, what can Lisa Marie do? I'm going to check her out live. I'm curious. I don't know the record. I'm just going to go see her.
Definitely.
And imagine, yeah, there was a transition where all of a sudden you realize you had fans.
Right.
And it wasn't that gawk factor anymore.
Right.
A huge relief?
Huge. Yeah. Yeah.
What do you think they're connecting with?
Sorry?
What do you think they were connecting with? The lyrics?
I mean, I can only base it on the letters and the stories that I've gotten from the people themselves. And usually it is the lyrics of the songs or something got them through something, you know, which is what I set out to do. So, I mean, yeah, the first thing was a curiosity thing. And I did feel that, and it was a little intimidating. But then, you know, that sort of, the music kind of spoke in the end, which I was happy that happened, you know.
You talked.
Thank you. Thanks.
You talked about, and this can even apply for this record, how some of the songs, you were crying when you were writing them.
On this one?
Mm-hmm.
Mm.
And I'm imagining a sense of purging. Almost.
Yeah.
And artists talk about it being therapeutic.
Right.
And it seems like you had that experience too.
I had, I always do that. I mean, that's sort of, the music I respond to is very honest, purging type music, and so that's what I do as well. And I think on this one it was Raven that I did, that I, you know, kind of got emotional while writing, so. Yeah.
And what has your mom said about that song?
She loves that song. That's her favorite song, so, you know. Which, you know, is understandable. I wrote it for her. But she likes it.
Well, the liner notes are interesting on this record. Like little messages almost.
Yeah, it's almost like a novel.
To the people close to you.
Yeah.
What was your mom's reaction after hearing some of that?
I played it for her when she'd had a couple glasses of champagne, actually. And then she really liked that. I don't know if it was because of the champagne or because she actually liked it. But then the liner notes, she did get very emotional when I read them, when I gave them to her recently. Okay. Yeah.
I'm curious if Don Henley has... If you've heard from Don Henley yet.
I have not heard. No, I haven't heard. No.
Wow.
Mm-mm. Okay. No.
Does it surprise you that, you know, like 22 years after that song is written, our culture is even more so geared toward that element of entertainment?
I mean, it does. It's just, it was so, dominating then. And obviously he felt the need to write the song at that point, which was the early 80s. And we have come such a long way. With what our entertainment is and crap, you know, and sensationalism and stuff like that, that I felt that it was a great cover and, you know, a good subject to reintroduce to people, you know, because it's, and then funnily enough, you know, while I'm promoting in the United States this record, it's like I explain the whole thing, you know, why Dirty Laundry, and I'm basically like, why not? And then, and it's not about me particularly, but they always, they understand it and they get it. And then when I'm done with the interview, whatever they've, you know, then they've done the song, you know, they've sensationalized the caps or crazy and not at all what I said or taken out of context. And it's like, it's just going over people's heads, which is kind of funny.
Well, rest assured, this is going to be a good experience for you.
No, I know.
Trust me. I would like to pursue a little bit later the... I would like to pursue a little bit later just the idea of our culture and where it's going.
Okay.
And get your take on that. But this is not about me asking all the questions, you understand. We're bouncing it around all over the place.
Yeah.
We have an email question.
Okay.
From Erin in New Brunswick. Will you ever remake one of your father's songs? She wants to know.
Well, I don't have it in my immediate future. I'm not saying it's out of the question. I just don't have... I mean, my whole purpose is to sort of make my own thumbprint, and that would kind of defeat the purpose right this moment. But... I guess at some point, if I feel like I've sufficiently done that, I mean, it wouldn't be out of the question. Yeah.
In 97, at the Elvis in Tribute concert at the 20th anniversary of his death, mm-hmm. you performed a sort of duet.
Right.
Your choice in the song?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah.
And it just sort of encapsulated the moment and the relationship, I'm imagining.
The what?
It sort of just encapsulated everything about... more or less why you did that song. It spoke to people and you that way, I guess.
Yeah, I thought it was pretty emotional and timely, considering what that event was for. And it wasn't to exploit that or anything. I did it for the fans that night, and I didn't realize it was gonna, you know, get out as much as it did. It got bootlegged and everything, which I didn't expect, but I guess I should have. No, it was just like a one-time deal, but I felt it was pretty appropriate for that.
And the song was?
It was called Don't Cry Daddy.
Don't Cry Daddy, yeah. Okay. An audience question right now. I believe Giselle is behind me. Does someone have a microphone? The person holding the microphone,
Hi.
I imagine, is Giselle.
Hi. What's up?
Hey, Giselle.
How are you?
Good. My question for you is, your music speaks to so many different emotions, love, anger, appreciation. And aside from their messages and meanings, what is the one thing that you'd hope for your fans to take from your music?
You know, I think that... I think a lot of my music has to do with, in different ways, realizing that you're not, you know, what everyone's expecting of you or what you should be or, you know, any kind of rebel or outcast or someone who doesn't feel like they're, you know, doing the right thing or they're not what people expect of them or whatever you want to call it. It kind of goes at that subject a lot. And I think that anybody that's in that position would relate to this. And I hope that, you know, it'll bring them out of it, or at least let them know that there are other people out there that feel that way. Yes. Thank you.
Thank you, Giselle. Thank you. Phone call from Edmonton. I believe this is Samantha. Hello, Samantha. Are you there?
Hi.
How are you?
I'm good, thank you. How are you?
Not bad. Well, I'm hanging out with Lisa Marie. Come on.
Hi, Lisa.
Amazing. Waited for this for a long time.
I have a question, obviously. Lisa, you were like the first person we watched sort of grow up in public, and I'm wondering if now you feel for people like the Olsen twins or Prince William and Harry kind of growing up in the spotlight? It must be really hard.
Right. I think that I do have other friends that are offsprings of, you know, famous singers. And I do talk to them. I know a lot of them that are very talented, but they're also afraid to cross this threshold because it's not easy, and I think they know that. You know, but it's something that I just said, you know, I'm just going to try to pioneer this and see what happens to a couple of them. And if, you know, you watch me and see what happens with me, and then, you know, you can either follow it or don't, you know, do the opposite. I hope I answered your question. Did I answer it?
Samantha, you like that? I'll speak on behalf of her. She loved it.
She did?
Yeah.
Oh, good.
I'm assuming she did. Is it hard to let people in? Are you guarded?
You know, I'm actually not that guarded. I might come across that way, but I'm not. I do genuinely appreciate people, and especially their sincerity. Like, it really affects me, so I'm very moved by people when they're being sincere. So I don't think so. If you're, you know, sincere and straight up with me, there's no problem. But if you're full of it, you might have another problem.
It comes across in the lyrics, too.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
It's funny. It's sometimes you seem vulnerable in the lyrics, and sometimes, you know, like, idiot is scathing.
I know. It's terrible. It's terrible.
It's not written about anybody in particular, though, is it?
Yeah, of course.
Is it?
Of course. Of course.
Okay, here's that dirty laundry aspect. Who?
It took a very long time before I'd had it with that person. I won't say who, because it'll ruin it. I think that song would be good for, like, sisters, bosses, parents, exes, you know, whatever you are upset at. Thanks. And I think it ruins it when people say who they're talking about when they're, you know. So, but I did take it for a long time from this particular person before I wrote that song.
That's not the kind of song where after you would cry, that's the kind of song after you wrote that, you're like, yes.
No, yeah, I was stomping my feet and screaming and woo, everybody was wondering what's happening. And I was like, oh, I've got it. It's so mean, it's good.
It's you?
I know, it's terrible, isn't it?
We have a text message. This is from Jason. Hi, Lisa. Do you have any fave comfort foods?
You know, I have to stay away from those, but I loved Mexican food, but it has absolutely no nutritional value whatsoever and makes you fat. So I had to switch over to Indian. So that's kind of what I do now. Vegetarian Indian food.
You are a vegetarian?
Yeah, I am.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. I was going to talk about other bad habits. I heard you were trying to quit smoking a few years ago.
Oh, yeah. So. Did we have to promote that I do that? Yeah, it's terrible.
You quit, though.
No, I'm quitting.
Okay. It's a slow process.
What?
It takes time.
It takes a little time.
You're on the right path.
It's the hardest thing I've ever tried to do in my life. And right, you know, with all this going on, it's even harder.
If there's any young people watching, they think they might pick up that nasty habit? No, because...
I hope not.
No.
Yeah.
Okay. We have, if you can look at the monitor behind me, we have a question from Halifax, actually.
Okay. What monitor?
Right up there.
Lisa Marie, I'm Liz here in Halifax, Nova Scotia, and I am just wondering if you could dispel any rumor about yourself or your family, what would it be?
Dispel any rumor about myself or my family?
That's what I get out of it, yeah.
You know, I think anything other than any of us from us is a rumor or a misconception, you know, if it's my father's music or his interviews or my music or my interviews, then you can judge us properly. But anything else is pretty much rumor and crap. Yeah.
There's some fun stories, though. I don't know. And the idea of running over frogs when you had a golf cart for your birthday on the grounds of Graceland.
I used to run over them. It's horrible. Yeah.
You were like, what, 6 or 7?
Yeah.
Okay, you can be excused.
I know, I'd step on them and everything.
If terrible. You do that now, that'd be mean.
Yeah, then but yeah, we might have a problem.
Okay.
You were just I might have to be locked away.
We have some people outside that would like to come say hi to you.
Okay.
Or they've been here for a while. So do you want to come with me over the window and say hi to these people? And I think one of them even has a question for you. Look, everyone, it's Lisa Marie Presley.
Hi.
This guy with the glasses here has a question.
Hi.
Who are you and where are you from?
I'm Paul. Big fan, very loyal.
Thank you.
I was wondering, when you're alone or driving down the highway, what do you like to listen to? Like, what CDs do you have?
I actually listen to... 70s satellite stations, believe it or not.
What does that include?
Whereas what?
What does that include?
That includes anything from the Bee Gees to Gordon Lightfoot to the Heart to John Denver to everything.
Okay.
Everything. Yeah.
I've seen you with photos with Pink, who's now a friend, I guess. Yeah. Avril. A couple of other people. These are at like backstage functions and stuff and parties. Are you fans of modern stuff, contemporary stuff?
You know, contemporary, I have to say U2. You know, definitely them. Got to be a big U2. Yeah, who else? I don't know.
Well, you know what? This isn't about any of those people. It's about Lisa Marie Presley.
Right, right.
This whole hour.
There's not as much as I'd like to say. I'm kind of old-fashioned in my music tastes. Yeah.
Well, thank you. Thanks for the question. I'm just going to let you know that we have way more conversation still to come and a performance from Lisa Marie Presley right after this, so don't go away.
If you would like to get live with Lisa Marie Presley, call 1-800-265-6824 or email us at lisamarie@muchmoremusic.com. You can also send a text message. Text Lisa Marie and your question to 54321. It's 50 cents per message. It took me all my life to finally figure out.
Here to perform the first single from the brand new disc, Now What This Is, Lisa Marie Presley.
1, 2, 3.
Very nice.
Thank you.
Sounded good.
Thank you.
And you know what? There's going to be some more performing still to come, and also some more conversation right after this, so don't go away.
Perception of what I am, I think, is a, let me think of a good one for this one. It's some sort of tabloid drama queen. It's not like I've needed attention my whole bloody life. I mean, they were pressed there the day I was born. If they know me better from this record, then that's actually what my whole point was in writing it. And you know who I am. You know how crazy I am. You read my lyrics. And how f***ed up I am, or how deranged I can get, or how dark it is, or how whatever I feel about whatever is right there. The melody's me, the words are me, I wrote it all. It's all there. We love to cut you down to size. We love dirty laundry. The downside was just the attention that I'm just sort of born with having. And the upside is where I came from, and I'm very honored to be part of where I came from. So it's kind of both. I'm trying to get rid of the celebrity aspect and trying to be an artist right now. So that's, I understand that I have to combat the speculation that's happened over the last 20, 25, 30 years. So I'm trying to break through that right now, try to get away from that stuff.
Welcome back. This is Much More Music Live with Lisa Marie Presley. You gotta see the album, you gotta be glad the album is finally here.
Sorry?
I said you gotta be glad the album's finally here. You've been talking about it, and the album is here now.
This one?
Yeah, now what?
Oh, good.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm happy.
But watching and paying attention to this media blitz in the past month or so, pertaining to what you said at the end there, you're trying to get away from all that stuff and just concentrate on you and your music. You're being asked the same questions now that you were 2 years ago.
Yeah, it's true.
No matter how crass
it's amazing.
Are.
It's truly amazing. And VH1's actually filming all this too, so it's going to be fascinating to see. they're filming the media on me, which a lot of them are letting them, and that's maybe dangerous. But you're going to see that exactly what you just said in this thing, I think, because it's pretty amazing. And then my different having to handle a question every time in a new way. And, you know, it's just that's what the nature of the beast, and it's like spitting against a tidal wave. But, you know, I'm spitting.
Any idea what it'll take just for it to stop and be gone and just forgotten?
I don't know if that's ever going to be the case, but more importantly, what I care about is my fans. And so as long as they're there and they want it and they're responding and that's happening and people are just listening to the music, I think I could keep it up. But if it keeps going into the other crazy stuff, I don't know what to say. You know, I might just move to an island somewhere.
Well, I don't know if you get a perception of people from the outside looking in to see what's happening, but God bless you, because you're one of the toughest chicks I have ever seen.
Thank you.
You got my respect, absolutely.
What?
You got my respect.
Thank you.
Absolutely.
I appreciate that.
You were CEO of Elvis Presley Enterprises.
Did I what?
You were CEO of Elvis Presley Enterprises?
Yes,
okay. Late last year, sold off 85%. There was a letter on your website to fans.
Right.
Sort of alleviating concerns is the sort of tone that I got from it. Was there a rumbling of people that were...
Only because it was falsely represented in the media, which they never do. I was really surprised. They basically said, I sold the estate. And I'm going, what are you talking about? I didn't sell the estate. The estate is very, you know, Elvis Presley's estate is the house and the things and all that stuff, which is mine. But the enterprises part, which is the business part, we merged with someone else who could take it to bigger and better places that we have been wanting to go for a really long time. In that merging, we merged with someone who could take it there. And we're also, we stay in control of it. So my mom, you know, we're very much involved with everything that still happens and always will be. My mother's on the board of the directors of the new company, and the new company, with that sale, actually the money came right back around and invested, reinvested itself in preferred stock into a bigger and better situation, because we were looking to grow. But it was such a complicated deal that it just, everyone was like sold, saw the word sold, and then that was it. It just, it ran.
Yeah. So EPE is better off.
Right,
saying,
EPE
ultimately.
Was merged, okay. And yeah.
And Graceland is still yours, all the contents are still yours.
Correct.
I've been on the tour a couple of times. The last time I was there, you're given a personal audio device,
right.
And so it's your mom guiding the tour through. Sometimes it's your voice guiding through the rooms. I'm sure most of you have been to Graceland. Well, for some reason you haven't, you gotta check it out. We have a little bit of footage of the tour and some of your voice that's on the recording.
Uh-oh.
So we can...
Graceland was always very alive. It had an energy and it was people always around. There was all kinds of stuff going on at all hours of the day and night. He definitely permeated the space.
You've called it a beautiful sadness.
I'm sorry.
You've called Graceland a beautiful sadness?
Yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah.
How often do you go back?
2 to 3 times a year. I'd like to get back more, but I still have family there and go back and at least every Christmas I go back.
Okay. Yeah. I don't know how else to describe your father as simply, other than the most important music figure in the 20th century.
Right.
Simple as that. At what point did you realize it?
One more time.
At what point did you realize it growing up?
I don't think I realized that as that. It's been happening since I was born, so I don't think I knew any different, to be honest with you.
It's like, well, all my friends, all their parents must be like this or something.
Yeah, no? But see, the thing about him was that there was nothing about him off stage. There was no machine behind him. There was no image making. He was himself. He was the person that connected with everyone through the music all the time. So there was no difference for me in that he sang and that he was, you know, just as big off stage as he was on.
Rose has a question over there. Hello, Rose.
Hi. Hi, Lisa. Hi, Bill.
Hi, how are you doing?
We didn't forget about you.
Okay. It's not about me. It's about Lisa Murray.
Lisa, I noticed George Michael was in your Dirty Laundry video.
Right.
And I was just wondering how that whole thing came about and if you have any future plans of recording with him or doing a duet or anything like that.
Well, if I don't get whiplash trying to talk to you. Actually, I wanted certain cameos in the video. And I've always felt really bad for him because I felt like he had a really bad rap for, you know, something personal happened and he could never come out from under it. And he was a perfect example of the song, one of many. But he just so happened to, like, make an announcement that he was going to retire, like, the week that we were looking at what we were going to do with the video. And I just called him and I said, please, just be in this thing, at least say your last hurrah if that's what you're doing. And he called back himself and he was like, I'd love to. And I was really happy he did that. Yeah. Yeah. Thank you.
Phone call from Halifax. And this is from Max. How you doing, Max? Are you there?
Yeah, hey, Bill.
How you doing?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm doing pretty good.
Good. Hey, Lisa. I'm loving the show.
Hi.
How do your kids feel about their mother being such a sex symbol?
Oh. Wow. I don't think I'm that, but thank you. I think they probably think it's a bit cool and a bit weird at the same time, you know? I can't imagine they'd, you know, too much of one or the other would be weird, so I don't know. I don't think, they definitely don't see me like that at home, because I don't.
If they were watching this right now, they'd go, Mommy?
Yeah,
sex symbol.
Yeah.
No,
yeah.
Jen has a text message for you. It's, hey Lisa, who is the male celebrity version of you? The male celebrity version of you.
Wow, good question.
I don't know why I'm thinking about it. It's,
you know,
question
the first person that would pop into my head would be Johnny Depp, and that might be really presumptuous. I mean, that might be giving myself way too much credit, but that's what popped right into my head when you asked.
In terms of what? Like sort of vibe?
In the Pirates of the Caribbean character.
He was a drunken Keith Richards.
The what?
He was a drunken Keith Richards
exactly.
persona. Okay.
No, not because of that. I don't know.
Okay, from Vancouver, we have a question. If you can look at the monitor again.
Hi, my name's Coral and I'm from Vancouver. I want to know, what will it take to get Lisa Marie Presley to do her own reality show?
The answer would be you'd have to kill me and film my corpse. Which they would do, I'm sure, you know. Film me dead and then you can have a reality show.
Some would say your whole life has been a reality show, though. So.
Possibly.
This other network that is walking around filming you, what is that going to be exactly?
Oh, the one we don't speak of?
Well, people aren't stupid. They know what's going on, but I just don't want to mention it. Is that sort of like a reality-based kind of...
It's only about the music. It's not about anything personal. So it's about... They've been following me, you know, beginning of the record, during the record, and then a little bit after the record. It's all about the work and the music and what goes on. They did... It's called Inside and Out. They did the same thing on Velvet Revolver, so it's something like that.
Do you watch a lot of your own stuff back?
Oh, I can't. Like, I won't... Yeah, it's hard. Like, I won't watch this.
Really? How come?
Because I'll probably hate the way I look and the way I'm sitting and the way I'm talking and, you know, I'm...
Do you read your own press?
I wish you guys were there every time I woke up in the morning.
What I like about television, though, I think when you're an artist and you do a print article and you read that, it's like, I didn't say that. Where'd they get that from?
Yeah.
At least with television, it's immediate. You know, we're not putting words in your mouth.
True. But you can still edit if it's a long interview.
Not when it's live.
Yeah, no, true. But I mean, they can edit, tape it, you know, edit it down and put what they want and spin it the way they want.
Damn media. We're not media, we're your friend.
You what?
We're not media, we're your friends here.
Wait, it's different. It's different. I can tell the difference here. It's very different. There's more, you know, in the USA.
Well, an email question. We have an email question from Capri Mayor in San Diego. They ask if you could go back and give a young Lisa Marie any advice based on your life right now. What do you think you'd tell that young Lisa Marie?
Oh my God, where do you start with her? God, oh. The hard one, hard one. I wouldn't have listened. That person probably wouldn't listen either. God, I don't even know what to say. Whatever I could, you know.
Don't worry about it.
Thank you.
No, I'm not saying don't worry about it. You would tell the young Lisa, don't worry about it.
Right, maybe. Okay. Right, maybe.
Okay.
No, I don't know.
We have a phone call from LA. This is David. Hello, David.
Hey, how are you doing? Hey, Lisa Marie.
Hi.
Hold on, that voice sounds familiar.
It does?
A little bit.
I had a question for Lisa Marie.
Sure, go ahead. Call her.
Why is everybody laughing? She made a face, didn't she?
They're in a good mood, this audience here.
Hey, Lisa, tell me...
David from L.A., what's your question?
My question is, Lisa, do you recognize this voice? Because I'm a Canadian, too, and I live in Los Angeles, and you and I are friends.
Oh, you! What are you doing?
I'm calling you because I'm excited that you're in my homeland.
Hey!
Everybody, this is Uber producer, amazing composer, David Foster on the phone from L.A. right now.
I couldn't resist calling in because I've been watching Lisa Marie from afar the last few months because I haven't really spoken to her, but I'm just so impressed with this new record and the great lyrics and the effort you're putting forth, and I just wanted to be like the tiniest part of it up in Canada. And Lisa, we're just, Lynn and I are really proud of you for all the things you've been doing.
Thank you, David.
David, I have a question for you.
Yes.
You produced Lisa's performance at the Elvis in the Elvis concert tribute in 97.
Yes.
Could you see something back then that would have pointed to a successful music career now?
Well, what I saw was that I saw that Lisa Marie would probably rather have a root canal than have me produce her record. Because we have such different approaches to music. However, having said that, she was smart enough to know that I might be a good person to start with to kind of ease her into this recording thing. And I was smart enough to know that I wasn't the right person, but that this is a person that was going to have a great career if she handled it right, and I felt great about being the first person, you know? So.
David, thank you very much for calling.
Wait, I'm so happy you called. It's really nice to hear your voice right now.
I love that you're up there. You're doing great. I love the Oprah show. Love it.
Thank you.
And just one quick thing. You know, when I've known Lisa Marie for many, many years, and she's always been very, very shy, and to see her going to all these things, which she doesn't love, I know she's having a great time there now, but doing all this TV stuff is tough for her because she's a very private person. She's got something great to sell, she's got something great to say, and that's why she's out there promoting it. There's no other reason other than, you know. So I'll let you guys go.
Well said, David. Oh, David? David?
Yes.
Say hi to Molly for us.
What, Terry David's there?
Our good buddy Terry David, yeah.
Oh, is he in the audience?
No, but you'll probably see him before I will.
Oh, so. I see. You mean when I see him?
Yeah.
Okay, see you guys.
Bye.
Thank you.
Bye. That was nice. That was exciting.
That was fun. We are very proud of David here. I think anyone that makes it.
I didn't even know he was a Canadian. I swear to God that I feel really horrible.
Well, because he doesn't talk like a lot of us saying.
But I know him. Obviously I know his wife since I was four, and I know him really well. And I'm sitting here going, oh my God, yeah. But I'm really happy he called.
Well, we're gonna go to the window. We're gonna make some people happy out there.
Okay.
Do you want to do this little walk again? He tried to sign you, didn't he, at one point, David?
He did. Yeah.
So he wasn't kidding when he said you'd rather have a root canal.
Right. Yeah. No, he wasn't. No, I just. Yeah.
Nice. How you doing? Of course, Lisa Marie Presley back. This guy right here is holding the microphone. He has a question for you.
Hi.
Sure.
Hi, Lisa.
Hi.
I've got a question for you. Okay, if your children were to follow in your footsteps in the music industry, how would you feel? Would you encourage them or?
I'm a little reluctant on that one right this minute. While I'm in the middle of all this, it's a little like I kind of want them to watch me and see what happens and then decide. You know what I mean? Cool. Recently, I've changed my mind. I would have said know about that a while ago. I would let them do whatever they want, but right now I'm a little more like, just see what happens with me and then decide what you want to do. You know?
Well, prior to the first record, you were Mummy.
Right.
The first, To Whom It May Concern comes out, and all of a sudden Mummy is out there on the road playing songs. Was it a weird adjustment for them?
I think so. I think it was a little strange. They were probably a little, weirded out and thought it was cool at the same time.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, we're going to give you a little bit of a break. Some more performance after this. Don't go away. Welcome back. Here to perform the debut single from her debut record, To Whom It May Concern. This is Dirty Laundry. Sorry, not Dirty Laundry. What am I thinking? This is Lights Out, Lisa Marie Presley.
1, 2, 3, 4.
There we go.
Someone's on the lights out.
Of course, Lisa Marie Presley, once again. I'm going to stand here. You can sit. And I want you to introduce the band.
Michael Lockwood on guitar right here. And we have Paul Gordon right here. Nick Lashley on guitar.
Yeah. Thank you, guys. Sounded great. We're going to give you a little bit of a break, but it all continues after this.
It's been music. Everything's been music for me. My whole, I mean, anything that's, you know, it saves me. It gets me through everything. There's always a song that's always been my release. I always had a studio in every house I've lived in, and every time I'd go through something, it was, I'd write whatever that was about. But I would just do it sort of for my own reasons, to outlet whatever was going on. When I had gone through enough in my life where I feel like I needed to let it go and let people know who I really was through that, then I did that at the right time. For me, I only get inspired to write when I'm not happy, unfortunately. So there is a lot of that, but it's not all that. And no, I'm not bitter at all as far as where I've come from, but I have gone through things. I use music to get rid of those things. That's how I outlet the pain or the feelings that I'm having.
You're back with Lisa Marie Presley right here on Much More Music Live. And reminding people once again that it is all about the music.
It is what?
That it is all about the music.
It is, but I couldn't hear myself on that song when I was singing it, which was horrible. Thank you.
Okay. it is all about, for you, I think, also a couple of charity endeavors. I know homelessness is something that you have worked towards. Also, the fight against illiteracy.
Right.
You're big on. And the CCHR.
Yeah. That's just a Citizens Commission on Human Rights. And it's just, I'm part of I'm the spokesperson for the protecting of abuse of children in psychiatric drugging type of way. Thank you.
And that was actually the title track.
And it
was To Whom It May Concern was about the title track of To Whom It May Concern.
That's right.
We dealt with that issue.
That addressed that subject. And, you know, just there's like 8 million children that are being drugged because there's a whole thing where the schools drug the kids, they get money, and then the money, and it's crazy. It's a business right now. Multi-billion dollar business to diagnose, you know, any kind of behavior as some disorder and then drug them.
That's changing now.
Yes, because I testified, and from that testifying, there was a law passed that they can't mandatorily drug these children. They can't force the kids anymore in the schools.
Your dad always gave back.
Right. I mean,
one of the amazing things about Graceland is just the wall of checks that he had wrote to just hundreds of charities. Yeah. When did you realize in your life that that was a very, very important thing to do?
I think that that keeps you sane. I'm not happy just, I don't know if that was inherited or if I just realized that that's the only thing that actually really makes me happy is helping other people. So even being famous or blah, 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 blah doesn't do it for me. Personally, I don't feel, I get on these highs when I'm helping people that are like nothing else I've ever been on in my life. So that's just for me how I feel. I think it probably was handed down a bit. I'm not sure, but it's definitely something I'm passionate about. Yeah.
We're going to say goodbye to everyone here on behalf of all these people here. Thank you very much for coming.
Thank you.
And on behalf of everyone watching at home, thank you. We'll go to the window to say goodbye to these people.
Okay.
I wanted just to ask about the last song. Look, I can be a gentleman and help
right.
you down. Okay. The title track ends with a specific line.
Right.
Do you want to give it? Everything is gonna be.
Somehow I'll be all right.
Somehow I'll be all right.
Right.
I think it's the perfect way to end the record.
Thank you.
Strategically placed there?
Actually, no.
No?
No. I just like putting my title tracks as the last song. I've got a habit now of doing that.
Okay.
Yeah. But
you
it works.
Up your life that way right now, maybe?
Is it what?
Somehow it'll all be all right.
Yeah,
you
yeah.
Can sum everything up that way?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay. Well, thank you very
Thanks.
Much for being here, everyone. We're going to end this right now and saying thank you and have a great night, Lisa Marie Presley. Thank you for being here. It was a pleasure meeting you, by the way.
Thanks so much.